grip. So not only can he see from only one eye, his eye also looks like a bulging grape, a protruding grape. So this is one of the main characteristics of the Messiah Dajjal. The Holy Prophet also gave us many other signs of how to recognize and identify him. The Dajjal will be a young man, fair looking, with a reddish skin tone. He will have twisted or curly hair, and he will obviously have a blind eye. The Holy Prophet even went as far as to compare him with a man named Abdul Uzza ibn Qattan, who was from the tribe of Al-Huzza, who had died previously, and he tried to remind the Sahaba Karam that if you want to picture what the Dajjal looks like Ibn Qattan. He looks very similar to him. The Dajjal will appear on the way between Syria and Iraq. This is where he will emerge from and will spread mischief right and left. So the moment he arrives, he will start spreading mischief across the land. He will be childless. He will be very strongly built. He will have a thick, wide neck, almost wider even than his own head. So he'll have a very thick neck and he'll be very strongly built. He will have also a very awkward walk. The way he walks, there will be a slight limp or a slight defect in the way he actually walks. And these are all signs from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala where we observe that if this imposter was God, he certainly would have fixed the defect in his own walk and the problem with his eye. So if he was God, it is a clear sign, yet a lot of us will still be fooled. It is a clear sign for those believers to see that he is certainly not God. Otherwise he would have fixed these imperfections within himself. Abdullah ibn Umar narrated that the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, said, "While I was asleep, I saw myself in a dream performing tawaf around the Kaaba. I saw a good looking man with slightly long hair and water dripping from his head. I said, 'Who is this?' And they said, 'This is the son of Mary, Isa.' Then I turned around and saw another man with a huge body, red complexion, curly hair and one eye. His other eye looked like a floating grape. They said, 'This is the Dajjal.'" So this is a true dream of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, which he narrated to the Sahaba Ikram, that where he saw both these people together, the real Messiah and the false Messiah. And he clearly differentiates for us the difference between the two. Now throughout the time of the Holy Prophet, when he used to speak about the Dajjal, sometimes he would give it a lot of significance and sometimes not so much. And sometimes when he spoke about him, the Sahaba reported that after we listened to the Holy Prophet talk about the Dajjal for so long, and when we left the company of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, we felt as if the Dajjal was somewhere close by, around the corner somewhere. He spoke about it like that, that the time is so near. And this was 1400 years ago. Now one of the people that the Sahaba identified who they thought was a possible Dajjal, his name was Ibn Sayyad. He was thought to be the Dajjal by some of the Sahaba Ikram. And there is a hadith narrated by Abdullah ibn Umar who explained that Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu went along with the Prophet and a group of people to Ibn Sayyad to find out if in fact he is the Dajjal. And when the Holy Prophet approached him, he tapped him on the back. And Ibn Sayyad at that time was a young man, a teenager you can say. And the Prophet asked him, "Do you bear witness that I am the messenger of Allah?" Ibn Sayyad looked at him and said, "I bear witness that you are the prophet of the unlettered." Then Ibn Sayyad said to the Prophet, "Do you bear witness that I am the messenger of Allah?" And at that point, Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Give me permission to chop his head off. How dare he claim to be a false prophet?" And the Holy Prophet told Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu something very important at that time. He said, "If he is the Dajjal, you cannot kill him. If he is the Dajjal, you cannot kill him. It is not your destiny to kill him. And if he is not the Dajjal, then we would have killed an innocent. So let him be. Whatever he is saying, let him be. Let's not kill him because you will not be able to if he in fact was the real Dajjal." Because if you read the hadith further, we know that the person who will put an end to Messiah Dajjal is Jesus Christ himself. Hazrat Isa alayhi salam. He is the one who is destined to kill the false Messiah. And we will talk about that in a bit more detail later on. Another incident also related to Ibn Sayyad, the same person who was believed to be the false Messiah during the time of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, was an incident that happened after the death of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, when a group of Muslims were going for Hajj or Umrah. At that time, they set up camp before Makkah, and at that time what happened was that Ibn Sayyad and Hazrat Abu Sa'id were left alone together. And Abu Sa'id had a bit of problem staying alone with Ibn Sayyad because he still had doubts about him, whether or not he was in fact the Dajjal or not. Abu Sa'id asked him that sometimes I wish I could just hang myself from a tree and end my life because of the way people treat me and think that I am the Dajjal. So he engaged in a sort of a conversation with Abu Sa'id. Then he gave him some goat's milk, which Abu Sa'id refused because he was not sure whether or not he still is or not the Dajjal. And then he tried to reason with Abu Sa'id and he said, I am a Muslim, not a kafir. You are an Ansar and you know the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him, better than I do. And he told you that the Dajjal would be a kafir. I am a Muslim, so I could not be the Dajjal. Then he said, I am from Medina. You know that the Dajjal will not be able to enter Medina. I was born in Medina, so I couldn't be the Dajjal. Then he gave a third reason, that I have children, two children back in Medina, and you know that the Dajjal will not be able to have children. So just when Abu Sa'id was beginning to believe him, he said, but I know where the Dajjal is right now, and I wish I could be like him. And Abu Sa'id said, may the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on you for all the rest of your life. So in the end, when they investigated, they believed, the Sahaba believed that he was one of the smaller Dajjals, one of the false prophets who in the beginning, like I explained via one of the Ahadith, that he said that I am a messenger of Allah, would you bear witness that I am that? And at that time, the Holy Prophet had left him, he had let him be. So, like Ibn Sayyad, a lot of other false prophets came from time to time, even women false prophets as well, who claimed some kind of divinity, some kind of prophethood after the time of the Holy Prophet, peace be upon him. Another very important hadith that we see from Sahih Muslim is the hadith called the Hadith of Jassasa. It is a story of one of the Sahaba-i-Kiram. His name was Tamim ad-Dari. He was a Christian man who had embraced Islam, and he took 30 of his men and set sail on the Arabian Sea. The waves had tossed him for about a month, and it was a very treacherous journey, and for a month they floated on in the sea until they came to an island at sunset. And as they sort of crash landed on that island, they saw a beast who was so hairy that you could not tell his front from his back. And they asked him, what are you? And it said, I am Al-Jassasa. They said, what is Al-Jassasa? It said, O people, go to this man in the monastery, inside a cave, for he is very eager to know about you. So without even asking any questions, he said, I don't want to even know who you are. There is a person waiting for you inside that monastery, inside that cave. Go and meet him. He is waiting for you. As if that beast was expecting these people to arrive on that island. When the Sahaba went inside that cave, they found a huge man. And Tamim ad-Dari said that that man was the most best built man that any man had ever seen. The strongest looking man that any man had ever seen. Very muscular, extremely powerful looking. And they asked him, who are you? Now this man was in chains, he was shackled. His wrists, his legs, he was completely tied up in chains. And they asked him, who are you? He said, you will soon know about me. Tell me, who are you?